then, what we're going to do is drop a particle in the field. And when it's right here, we know its position, we know what direction it's headed in, and we know how fast it's going. At a slightly later time, it's going to be here, and we know its position. And if we watch that particle over time, is that particle is going to make a path. And we talked about how we can use parameters to describe the path of a particle. Like all of these, they start out easy, and they get hard. Particle starting at 0, 0, and my velocity field is 2i plus 3j. So at t equals 0, where is the particle? What's x?
2?
No.
2i?
No. Maybe that's way too hard.
X is irrelevant.
So, but it's 0. Somebody say that? Okay.
X is irrelevant. Y is irrelevant.
No, so the particle starts at 0, 0. So at time 0, what's the x coordinate? 0.
Zero.
The y coordinate?
Zero.
Very good. Okay, so it's this 2i and 3j tells us it's increasing by 2 in the x direction and increasing in 3 in the y direction. So at time 1, how much did x increase by? By 2. So it was at 0. What is it now? And then at time 2, where is it?
4.
Time 3?
6.
6, okay. And y's? So it starts at 0. The y rate of change is 3 feet per second. So 1 second later, where is it?
3 feet.
3.
Six.
And 6 feet.
Yeah. And are those all starting points?
No. Is the starting point was at t equals 0. And then 1 second later, this is where it was. 2 seconds at the start, this is where it is.
Is there like a point at some point?
Yeah, so let me draw a picture. So it's,
I'm going to draw, we'll steal the idea from atomic books, using different times as representing different places. So.
Taking some pictures. At time t equals 0, you see the particle here at z, yeah, 0, 0. 1 second later, you would see the particle up here at t equals 0. And then at time 2, it's at 4, 6. And then time 3, it's at 6, 9. So again, imagine that we've got this. We've got water flowing around here. Let me draw those vectors in. And at time 0, you just happen to take a picture, and this is what you can see. You see the particle right here. And then you took another picture at time t equals 1, and the particle moved to up there. And t equals 2, it moved up, and it moved up. So what I want to do is draw an entire path on just one picture. So t equals 0 over here, t equals 1 over here, t equals 2, t equals 3. And the path of that particle is going to look like that. And what does vector field look like? So what is the velocity at 0, 0?
What's
velocity at 1, 0? Yeah, this is the constant function where the velocity is always 2i plus 3j. So the actual field looks like this. And those are all the same vector. So what I want you to imagine is that the xy plane is full of water, and that water is all moving at a rate like this. So the velocity at any given point is 2i plus 3j. And then what we did is we dropped a particle right at the origin, and then we watched the path that particle took over time. So do you have the mental picture here? We just want to make it math. So we want the equation, we want to parameterize that line. In other words, we want an expression that gives us the position of the particle at any given time. For generic t, what's the x coordinate?
2t.
Good.
I.
And the y coordinate? 3t. You know, like where you're going with this, Travis? Is that's the calc 2 parameterization. The calc 3 parameterization is to do it with a vector. That's 2ti plus 3t.
How's this different from 17.1?
You will see. Okay, so Hilden, what was 17.1?
It was just like...
Oh, 17.1 was just the vector field.
Yeah.
What was it?
It was like turning a
parameterization.
Oh, you're right. No, you're right. Okay, so 17.1 was I describe it, and you come up with the parameterization. Where we're going to end up is instead of giving you a verbal description of it's a circle or a line with these properties, I'm just going to give you the velocity field that it's in, and the point it starts at. And the reason I chose this example was because it would tie back to the 17.1 stuff you know already. So you get the general problem, starting point, field that you're in, and then what I want you to do is figure out the path. So far, so good? Okay, and then, this is the key idea. Is how do you go from the position to the velocity?
Take the derivative.
Great example. So let's check it out. Is we've got our r of t, which is 2ti plus 3tj. So let's compute the velocity. If I do the derivative, it is? Which is what we want it to be. Okay, so that's the idea, is we're going to be given the starting point and a velocity, and we want to come up with a position function. And what we need for the position we come up with to match the starting point and the derivative to be this. So what had to happen is this 2 was the dx dt, and the 3 was the dy dt. Okay, so that's the setup. We're going to do another one. And the tricky part, and well, you'll see in a minute, is the constants made it easy. I'm going to raise the right board. Any objections? Better and better, doesn't it? Do you all have like a little production studio in your pocket now? You can like shoot videos and edit them. And you could actually be taking videos of my lecture. So if things go according to plan, I'm going to get copies of these and I'll post them on the Canvas so you guys can see them.
That's amazing.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Yeah, some in my pocket that, among other things, I'm going to take the video that you need. Okay, so no. So yeah, it'll be your own private Peralta Math 3C Smith channel.
See if Canvas lets you upload stuff that big.
We're gonna find out at some point. So, in theory, that's what's gonna happen. If not, we'll come up with a workaround. You're imagining is we've got the XY plane, and at every point we've got some water flowing around, and that function is going to tell us the velocity at any given point. So if we're here at 0, 0, what's the velocity?
One what?
I like 1J. You guys?
Yeah.
So X is 0, right? So 0 Y is 1J.
Yeah.
So if the particle was here,
yeah,
right at that moment, it would be traveling straight up with a speed of 1. And what if we were up over here, so that's 0, 0. If we're at 1, 0, what would the velocity be?
1i plus 1j.
Good. 1i plus 1j. So if we started the particle here, it would go over that way. And let's see, we're at 2, 3. What if we're at 2, 3? What's the velocity?
2i plus 1j.
So 2i plus 1j would be kind of like that. So I'd expect the particle's going to kind of do something like that. So the way we get the velocity, so I'm going to move this over. Get the velocity by doing the derivative of the position. And so this is dy dt, and that one is dx dt. So we'll do this one first. And so there's two things we know about y. We know dy dt is 1, and this way, at t equals 0, y is 3. So we're starting at 2, 3. So at time 0, our y value is 3, and we know that the velocity, the dy dt, is 1. So can you come up with a function that satisfies all of this? Its derivative is 1. And when I plug in a 0, I get 3. Everybody agree with me? The second one's going to be a little bit harder, but the idea is going to be the same. For the second one, what do we need dx dt to be?
X.
And we need at t equals 0, x has to be. The mistake that most people make on the exam is probably the one you're about to make. So just make a note here that you don't want to do this on the test. That's the mistake. That is wrong. Okay, so the important thing is the input variable is t. The output is x. X is the dependent variable. So this says we do the derivative of x with respect to t, and we get the x function back.
So plus
x t
plus 2.
No? It's a better guess. So actually, let's try this. So you want, x of t is, no, I just want a function of t.
T's.
Nope, just t's. Because we make this way too hard. So I'll look at this, I'm a calc 1 student, because I have some function x. And what's amazing is when I took its derivative, I ended up exactly back where I started. Can you remember, you know any function whose derivative doesn't change the function at all?
E to the t?
Yes. So So our first guess is x is e to the t. So does that satisfy, we call this a differential equation. We haven't had that class yet. So does this satisfy the differential equation? Is dx dt the same as x?
Yep.
And then we need x of 0 to be 2. So the trick we're going to do here is make it 2 times e to the t. So is the derivative of this equal to itself? And does x of 0, t equals 0, do we get x equals 2?
Yeah.
So the answer to our question, our r of t, is 2 e to the ti plus t plus 3 j. Yeah.
What about if x equals t plus 2?
Okay, so if x equals t plus 2, what is dx dt?
1.
But what do we need dx dt to be?
X.
Right. Didn't work.
Okay.
So I want to talk a little bit about this mistake that students often make, and then we'll go back and do some examples. At least one more. So at half x squared plus 2, let's look at these two slightly different problems. So it's easy to confuse these two. Yeah, I guess. So this says I took the derivative with respect to t, and I got t. What's your x of t there? Plus. Does see that is, and does this work? So check. When I do dx dt, that's 2 times 1 half t plus 0. That really does equal. Okay, on this one, dx dt equals x? No. So first of all, is our answer has to be a function with just t in it. So x of t is e to the t. Actually, technically it's c times e to the t. And let's do the check. What's dx dt? So if my function is c times e to the t, what's the derivative?
C
times e to the t. And what's x?
C to the t.
So does it work? Okay, again, so notice the difference is this one is, this is the independent variable, it's the input variable. And then it's just a regular integration. Is this one, is this matches the variable up there, and then it's a harder problem. So right now, it's, I'm going to make the problems easy enough that you can use Calc 1 techniques to figure it out. This differential equations is you're going to learn how to solve problems like this. Do you want to do a quick detour to the algebra for this? Please, or? Yeah? So again, it's, you're not going to be responsible for this. I'm going to make it on the exam so you don't have to. So on that first one, is dx over dt a fraction?
Looks like it.
Yes, it is. Yes. So actually, I used to be the only one in the math department who believed that, but I've convinced Fred now. So dx dt is t.
T, not x?
I'm going to do the first one.
Okay.
I'm going to do the second one.
What did you just?
This is, what's that?
What did you just, oh, okay. Yeah, you've done it already.
So this is, you're gonna learn what I'm about to do in differential equations.
Integrate both sides.
Very good. So we're gonna integrate both sides. What's the integral of dx?
X.
And the integral of t dt? One half t squared plus c. So that's how we can look at the equation and do the algebra together.
think we did a little bit of it in Calc 2 in our class.
What's that?
I think we did a little bit of that in our Calc 2 class.
Okay. Yeah, it sounds like it's, there's, I guess there was a Calc 2 class that happened recently where you did a lot of differential equations. So then, okay, so the second one is separable equations. You've probably seen this before. I'll either show you again to remind you, or this will be a new class, or I've never seen it before. Okay, so what I do is I'm going to give all the x's to one side and all the t's to the other. I'm going to integrate both sides again. And so let me write this as 1 over x dx is 1 times dt. What's the antiderivative here?
Ln of x.
So ln of x. And there's going to be a plus c here and a plus c there. I'm just going to combine them on one side.
Equals t.
Equals t plus c. And then if I solve this for x, e to the t plus c, which I'm going to write as e to the t times e to the c. So that's, you're going to learn a lot of tricks like that in your differential equations class. But I'm going to set it up. So what I want you to see here is we took the derivative of a function and ended up back where we started. What's the function from Calc 1 that had that property? The e. Question?
I don't know which side, but just see.
Doesn't matter. Because if you put, I mean, I guess what we could do is we could do log x plus c equals t plus t. But I could put a constant on each side. Then I can move this c over to the other side and call that my new constant. Again, don't worry about this technique if it didn't make sense. You'll have an entire semester for this and this. You guys are Calc 3 students, right? So I'm good with that. This is one of those famous fields that's going to keep coming up. So you should have a picture of this. What's your picture of this?
Circle.
Yeah, but this is the circle. This in the circles. How do you parameterize a circle? You got the x is cosine, the y is sine. We're going to see how that works here. So remember, the way we get the velocity field is by doing the derivative of the position. We have is dx dt is negative y and dy dt is x. Okay, so now what we're doing is we're looking for a pair of functions where they're derivatives of each other, but one of them is the function itself and one is the negative. Can you think of two functions? So if I do the derivative of x, I get the negative of y. But the derivative of y is just x. Cosine and sine, right? So x is cosine t. Y is sine t. And does that work? What's the derivative of x? Negative sine, which is just negative y. What's the derivative of sine? Cosine, which is x. So at this stage, I've made them easy enough as things you recognize from Calc 1. I'm going to throw this out there because it's interesting. Actually, I'll wrap it this way. For linear algebra.
matrix form, it's, this is the equation we're looking at. And if you look at the characteristic equation, so if you try to find the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, it's, and the characteristic equation is lambda squared plus 1 equals 0. What are the solutions?
Plus minus 1?
Plus minus I. And then we did stuff with this back in linear algebra, you see the differential equations. So anyway, that I gives us the sines and the cosines.
And that's just a counterclockwise rotation?
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And we talked about that. Yeah. Multiplying by I is multiplying, which is exactly the kind of rotation that you expect there. Yes. It was a lot of work to make linear algebra a prerequisite for differential equations. So I was reading on Reddit, people were arguing that they should make linear algebra a hard prereq for this class too. I agree with that. I want to go through all the work and make it happen. Sometimes is we can do a numeric approximation. If we can't solve exactly, we can at least do a numeric approximation to what we're looking for. This will come up as one of the homework problems.
In the node you have t equals 0.
Say that again?
In the node you have t equals 0. Just
okay, so yeah, I'm going to, all my starting, I'm always going to start at t equals 0, unless I say otherwise. Okay, so sometimes is you're not able to solve the derivatives. Can you think of two functions where the derivative of x is y and the derivative of y is negative 2x?
The sine and cosine. Mm-hmm.
So maybe they do, maybe they don't, and that's a topic for your differential equations class. But we can at least approximate it. So what I can do is if I give you a time, or at least at time zero, I can tell you where we start, and the field tells me what the velocity is. So if I know where I am, I know what direction I'm going and how fast, I can figure out where I am at the next time step. And then I can recompute velocity and keep working. So time t equals 0, what's x? What's y? And what's my velocity?
This is minus 2.
Say it louder.
Minus 2.
No.
I minus 2.
So the whole point of a velocity field is the input is your position, and the output is the velocity at that point. Input is position, output is velocity. And then in particular, I'll put units on it, slightly easier to think about. The x velocity is 1 foot per second, and the y velocity is negative 4 feet per second. And I erased it already, but I said we're going to use time steps of half a second. So the next time we're going to look at this is at t equals 0.5. So what's my x velocity? If I'm going at 1 foot per second for half a second, how much did x change by?
0.5.
1f? Yeah, 0.5. So 0.5 feet. So the old x was 2. It went up by 0.5. So the new x is 2.5. What's the y velocity?
Minus 4.
So delta, oh, 4 feet per second. So delta y is?
Good.
So we're going at -4 feet per second for half a second, which is -2 feet. So what was y?
-6.
No, what was the old y value?
1.
And
-1.
It's negative. So right now, let's summarize. At t equals 0.5, x is 2.5, y is -1.
What was the objective here?
We're trying to get a rough idea of where the particle is at time 1.5.
Oh, okay.
So we're going to see where at time 0, we know where it is, we know the velocity. And then, as an approximation, we're going to assume that the velocity is constant over this half-second time interval. And then it's going to be at a new place. And then we're going to recompute the velocity and get its new position. And so that's going to be the process. We have the position, we get the velocity, assume the velocity is constant, go forward in time, new position, new velocity, follow that path for another half-second, and see where you end up after 1.
So they're splitting up the time into slices.
Exactly. So you different. So who is taking or has taken the differential equations course? Okay. So you two people. What am I doing here? This is Euler's method. You remember Euler's method?
No.
Okay, anyway, you will see this in differential equations, and there's a name for this. It's called Euler's method. Oh, that's exactly what it is. Yeah, yeah. We're using a slope field to recompute. Absolutely right. So this. Okay. So what's the f here? Negative I. I'm going 5j. Agree? So if I know the position, I can plug in and get the velocity. Let's pull it apart. What's the x velocity? -1 per second. And the y velocity?
-5 per second.
And I'm going to move this over to the other side of the board. So we did all our computations at t equals 0.5. And now we're going to go over to time 11. So how much time elapsed? 0.5 seconds. So the x here was 2.5. -1, is that right? So that's -1 foot per second. For half a second, what's the delta x? So the velocity is -1 foot per second. If I went for 5 seconds, what would happen?
-5.
If I went for half a second,
negative
a half. So the delta x is -0.5. the new x, well, x was 2.5. It changed by going down by 0.5. So what's the new x value? At t equals 0.5, we have a y coordinate of negative 1. What was the y velocity here? -5 feet per second. So what I want you to do is calculate what the delta y should be and what the new y is. What's the delta y? -5 feet per second for half a second? -2.5. What did y start at? It changed by -2.5. Where are we now? So let's summarize this t equals 1 again. We've got x equal to 2. We've got y equal to negative. And we've got three options. I could say you get the idea, and we can move on to another problem. Is I could have you try to do it, or I could do it for you.
The last two options. Have us try to do it.
Okay, sounds good. So you guys try to do this. Yeah, so it's going to be the same idea, as we're just trying to go from time 1 to time 1.5. So figure out what the velocity must be here, figure out the delta x, the delta y, and use that to get the new x.
Should that delta x on the left side be -0.5?
Delta
or 0.5?
Yeah.
-0.5.
Negative.
So the velocity is -1. And so we're going dropping at 1 foot per second for half a second.
Okay.
So we drop by half a foot. You see?
I think so.
I what's the velocity at time t equals one? -3.5i -4j. In particular, the x velocity is -3.5. It's what's the delta t from time 1 to time 1.5? 0.5. So the delta x is 0.5 times -3.5, which is -1.75. So x is 2. It changed by -1.75. What is it now? 2. What's the y velocity?
-4.
So in at -4 feet per second for half a second, how much did y change by? The old y was -3.5. What's the new y? -5.5. What's the x?
0.25.
And y? Approximation for where we are at time 1.5 is 0.25 -5.5. You're going to see this again in differential equations. They're going to call it Euler's method. And essentially, it's doing a calculation with a slow field.
So change of
velocity
times delta y.
Yes. So the change in y is the y velocity times delta t. So it's the y velocity is change in y over change in time, which is -4.
Yeah.
And then from t equals 1 to t equals 1.5, where delta t is 0.5.
Yeah, 0.5 times -4.
Yeah, exactly. Which is -2. Okay. Remember looking through the homework here, just want to make sure you know how to do all the problems. More type of problems you're going to run into. Instead of having to figure out the answer, what the parameterization is, you just have to verify it works. So, and the path of my particle is 2 e to the t, x is 2 e to the t, y is 3 e to the minus t. Do you have a feel for what that graph looks like? So where does it start?
Oh, it's going up.
2, 3. So what happens as t gets bigger, is the x going to increase or decrease? What's going to happen to x?
Increase.
And y?
Decrease.
Right. So the x is going to get bigger, and the y is going to go to 0. So the particle flow would look something like that. You just have to verify this algebraically. verify that this describes the flow of the particle or the position of the particle at time t, is we have to verify that at time zero, we've got the right x and y coordinates, and that the derivatives work out the way they're supposed to. So let's try it. X of zero to e to the zero. And is that equal to two?
Equal to two.
Yes, check. We've got that with that. Y of zero is 3e to the minus zero. Is that equal to three?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Good. Another check there. So what's dx dt?
2 e to the t.
About 2.
So this is my x function. What's the derivative of that?
2 e to the t.
2 e to the t. And x equals 2 e to the t. So do we have dx dt equals x?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And dy dt?
Negative 3 e to the
negative
t.
And negative y is negative 3 e to the minus t. Do we have dy dt equals negative 1?
Yep.
So all the pieces are in place, and we verify that this really is the solution to this problem. And you see that's easier than actually coming up with it yourself.
Oh, definitely.
In the last example I have in this section, is I'm going to give you two fields, and I'm going to give you some flow. I'm going to give you two algebraic descriptions of fields. I'm going to give you some flows in the field without lines. I mean, some fields with some flows, undirected. You're going to identify. You're going to match the field, the drawing of the field, the algebraic representation, and you're going to decorate. So again, these are describing velocity fields. And what you want to think about is this is a river or some sort of lake with the water moving around. And these functions, you give me a position, and I'll tell you the velocity of the particle at that position. And the flow lines is on this one, if I just looked at the path the particle took, it traveled along this straight line. And I didn't put the arrows on, so either it went down this way along the line, or back that way, or I guess it could have even gone back and forth. Just one flow line is this line. Another flow line, another particle started somewhere else, and somehow ended up making this path. So your job is to match the field to the flow line, and then put the directions. So what I see on that first one is a constant field. So no matter where I am, the velocity is going to be the same. So what would happen if every point is moving in the same direction at the same speed? If I dropped a particle in there, what would I see?
Straight line.
Straight line. So this one has to go here. And would the particle go from top left to bottom right, or would it go the other way? Bottom right to top left. Is the particle traveling, or would that be southeast or northwest?
Southeast.
So, is dx dt positive or negative?
Positive.
If you have a positive derivative,
What does that tell you about the function itself?
It's increasing.
And dy dt is negative, which implies y is decreasing. Okay, so we want positive x's and negative y's, and that would only happen if the arrows go that way. Let's at least start here. Let's call this point little a. So, if I pick a point in quadrant one, is dx dt positive or negative? No.
Dx dt is negative.
So, like, let's say this is the point 1, 2. What would dx dt be? So dx dt is negative, dy dt is negative. Okay. So is x increasing or decreasing? So in terms of x's, it's going that way. Is y increasing or is y decreasing?
Y decreases.
So if both of those are true together,
everything goes to the center.
It's going to be going to the center. Oh, because remember, in a velocity field, is the coefficient of I is dx dt, and the coefficient of j is dy dt. That's how we get the field. And let's try something here. Let's call this B. So give me a typical point in B. Give me an x and a y. That's definitely
zero.
So it's quadrant four, positive x, negative y.
Mm-hmm.
So what's dx dt? Positive or negative?
Negative.
It's one of the two.
Negative.
Yes. And dy dt?
Positive.
Okay, so if dx dt is negative, that means it's going that way. The x's are decreasing. And what about the y's?
Positive,
they're increasing. So we have to have this direction for the x, that direction for the y, and that's going to happen if I go in that way. And you can check the other two. You'll find that all of these are heading toward the origin. Get us started on the next section. I think it was you, Travis, who was talking about this. Okay, here we go. It's always a proper end. So imagine I took this paper plate and bent it. If I bent it this way, could this paper clip fit in the xy plane?
No.
So this lives in three-dimensional space. But the object itself is a one-dimensional object. So this is a one-dimensional object that lives in a three-dimensional space. And, or like, remember the helix we had?
What do you mean it's a one-dimensional object? You mean if you flattened it, it would be?
No.
Or?
Yeah, essentially, it's just a line that I twisted.
That's what I mean. If you like straighten the whole thing out, then it's one dimensional? Or?
But it's still one dimensional.
Like,
so a line's a one dimensional object.
Right.
And then if I twist it, it's still a one dimensional object. I just need a higher dimensional ambient space to contain it in.
Is it one dimensional because it doesn't have like a mass or a volume?
Because it's a twisted line, I guess is the best way to say that. Yeah, if you had to talk about, maybe I think I know what you're getting at. So So if you had to ascribe a unit to this, would you describe its length, its area, or its volume? Its length. So one-dimensional things are you care about the length. Two-dimensional things you care about the area. Three-dimensional things you care about the volume.
Okay.
And so what about a helix? There's no way I'm going to be able to imagine I bend this into a helix. So what's the dimension? Kind of happening. What's the dimension of the object?
One.
It's a one-dimensional object, and it lives in what, the ambient space has how many dimensions?
Three.
Three, right. And the helix, or at least one helix, as we talked about this. Okay. So the dimension of the ambient space is how many vectors we need. Actually, it's how many coordinates we need to describe a point on this. Or in other words, it's how many vectors we need to describe the parameterization. And the fact that it's a one-dimensional object means we only need one parameter for, we only need to use one parameter to describe it. So 3D points. The ambient space is three-dimensional. The object is one-dimensional. The last thing we want to do in this section is talk about how to parameterize surfaces. So a flat piece of paper has how many dimensions?
Two.
And I can still deform it. It's still a two-dimensional object. It just lives in a higher dimensional ambient space. So this is a two-dimensional object that lives in a three-dimensional space. So how many coordinates do we need to describe a point on this surface?
Three.
And how many parameters do you think it's going to need?
Two.
Exactly. So what we're going to do is everything that up to this point has been a parameterization of a one-dimensional surface or a one-dimensional object. And now what we're going to do is figure out how to parameterize two-dimensional objects. I was about to show you a lot of the fun things that are going to come up. I will let those unfold as they do. So I'm going to see you in 10 minutes. Parameterize surfaces. And we talked a bit about what we'd expect is if the ambient space is three-dimensional, points on that surface are described by an XYZ coordinates, and we're going to need two parameters to describe that two-dimensional surface. Try to get a mental picture of what this looks like. When you just look at X and Y, if you're not worried about the Z coordinate yet, what do you see? If x is cosine and y is sine, what do you see?
Circle.
You see a circle. So different t values give you different points in that circle. And then z is a choice that's different from t, is you can pick anything you want for z. So in x and y, you have to be on a circle. And your z value could be anything. What's the shape? No?
Cylinder.
Cylinder. Okay, maybe let's look at it this way.
So the increase of s and t is a tie, they can be completely separate.
Right. Yes, the idea of different letters for parameters mean you make it completely. You can make any choice you want for t, any choice you want for s. So let's imagine I'm going to pick t equals pi over 4 and s equals 7. Okay, the way parameterization works is the parameters are independent variables, so they're completely free choices. And then the actual point, the x, y, z coordinates are determined by your s and your t. Actually, no, let's go pi over 2. Okay, so if t is pi over 2, in the x, y plane, where am I?
First quadrant.
right here between first and second? Okay. So my x is, this example, my x is 0, my y is 1. And what's my z here?
7.
So the z-axis is coming out at you. I picked a point that's 7 units above that. What if I pick t is pi over 2 and s is 3? So now what do I have? It's in the xy plane, I'm here. X is 0, y is 1. And what's the z now? So the way a parameterization works is you make some new independent variables, and then based on the values you pick for the parameters, you determine the point in space that you're at. So if I have a cylinder, it's the ambient space is what dimension? This lives in what space?
Three-dimensional
space. And what dimension is the object? It's a two-dimensional object. This is a two-dimensional object because it's a piece of paper deformed then that lives in a three-dimensional space. Z is dependent. So you get to pick any value you want for t, any value you want for s. Then once you pick those values, x, y, and z are determined.
So in that, if s equals 7 and z equals 7 is 4?
Yeah, in this example, it's a little misleading because the z is the s value. But usually, you've got a function here and a function here. And these, they don't even need to be separate. Is you might need to know s and t to get x, you might need to know s and t to get y, and you might need to know s and t to get z. So if you're designing something to be run into a 3D printer, and so you've got this cool 3D shape in mind to try to figure out how to describe it, then you can do a parameterization and then take the values of s and t. So our basic one-dimensional objects are lines and circles. What's our basic two-dimensional object? It's the simplest two-dimensional object you can think of?
A plane.
Yeah. So, simplest for me is a plane. So it's just like I wanted to be able to parameterize a line, I wanted to be able to parameterize a circle. It's also, we're going to have to talk about how to parameterize. So I'm going to describe my plane. And then we're going to come up with a bunch of points, and then we're going to see if we can come up with a description or parameterization of the points that we've got. So my plane, it contains the point 007. And the vector I is in that plane, and the vector j is in that plane. So one point in the plane is 007. And what if I went one unit in the I direction? So I is in that plane. It means I can follow I.
107.
So another one. What if I started at 007 and I did 3 i's? What would it be?
307.
What if I started at 007 and did 1 j? Where would I be?
2017.
So can you give me some more points in this plane?
24,
4,
and 7.
Yeah. 24, 4, and 7. Does everybody agree? Mm-hmm. So we started at 007, did 24 i's and 4 j's. another point in the plane?
1, 1, 7.
1, 1, 7, good. What's, if you were trying to describe to somebody how to answer my questions, imagine the person sitting next to you didn't know how to get the answer, and you just wanted to give them a method, what would you tell them to do? So imagine everybody has to come up with a different point in this plane. What's the trick?
Z equals 7.
Z is constant?
Yeah, you have to make z equals 7. What about the x?
Free choice.
Free choice. What about the y?
Free choice.
Good. So the parameterization is parameters are exactly what we use for free choices. So x, we'll use the letter s, is x can be anything you want. Y can be anything you want. So we represent that as another parameter t. And what do we know? Z has to be 7. And sometimes we'll need to vectorize this, so si, tj. So either as x equals y equals z equals 4, as a parameterization, is I or j.
Oh, you have another one over there.
I do. Yay, bonus day.
Well, this is actually fully free choice, because like if you certain combinations doesn't make a point.
For this particular plane, it's every point on the plane is exactly described in this one.
So any four combinations on the plane?
No. It's for this one, as I gave you one point on the plane, so it contains 0, 0, 0. And then I also told you is that I is in the plane. So if you just follow the vector I, you're going to stay in the plane. And I told you if you follow vector j, you're going to stay in the plane. So if that happens, this is the mathematical way to describe that plane. You see it? Do you see this?
Yeah.
So if this sum contains 2i, it would be exactly the same, right?
Yes.
It's just scaling i.
Absolutely right. Now, it's my plane has I plus j, and it's got k. And it also has the point 0, 0, 0. So it's your job to come up with some more points in the plane. So what if I'm at 0, 0, 0, and I just did the I plus j vector? Where am I? No. I'm going to move 1 unit in the I direction and 1 unit in the J. So if I start at 0, 0, 0, and then I'm going to use the vector I plus J to get me to another point. So I is 1 unit in the X, J is 1 unit in the Y. Agreed? I'll use a 3k. So as David pointed out, if k is there, then 3 times k has to be there. So if I'm at 0, 0, 0, and then I use 3k to get to a new point, where am I? Imagine I'm going to use the 0, 0, 0. I'm going to use 2 I plus j's where do I end up?
So.
Imagine everybody had to give me a different point on the plane. So, give me another point on the plane.
Three I.
So, I need three numbers.
Four, seven.
Three, four. Say what?
Three, four, seven.
What's it?
Three, four, seven.
It is not on the plane.
Four, six.
So, remember, is to be on the plane, is you have to start with 0, 0, 0, and then do some I plus J's, and then some K's. So do you see that whenever you use an I plus J, is the X and Y are gonna be the same?
Okay, so 5, 5, 7.
Yeah, excellent.
And the Z has to be a multiple of K? I mean, three?
Nope, just Z could be any, I think Z could be anything.
Okay.
So it has to be something in the direction. One more?
What about the one?
Can you go in the negative direction?
Sure.
Okay. I don't know, 10, 10, negative 2.
Excellent. So if you're going to describe in English, right, the person next to you doesn't want to be embarrassed. So what do you tell them to do?
X equals S.
Yeah, so the first two have to be the same. And then the third one is a completely free choice. So anything you want, they just have to match. And that third one has to be different.
But the first two can be negative 2.
They can. It could be -5, -5, 8.
So this is the vertical plane where x and y are the same.
Right. Yeah, absolutely right.
So it's going to be S, S, T.
Good. So x is a free choice. Make it S. And then you have to make sure that the y coordinate matches the x coordinate. So y has to be S as well. And the Z coordinate is another free choice, which is T.
So like, what do they mean? Like, is it like, are they all the same or something?
Yes. Yeah, so it's what I've done is I've given you a description. I've told you some things about this plane. I've told you two vectors in the plane, and I've told you a point in the plane. And then we came up with a bunch of points that have to be in the plane. We saw the general rule for generating points was pick any number you want, and make sure x and y are the same. And the math way of describing that is pick any number you want, make sure x and y are the same. And then you can make another free choice, not dependent on those two, for the z-coordinate.
And what's the purpose of telling us that it's 0, 0, 0?
Oh, because if... if I told you that 1, 2, 5 is in the plane, and then we used an I plus J on that, where do we end up?
Oh, so
that would be 2, 3, 5. So to get this parameterization that those two have to match, is we have to, AX and Y have to start out as at the same number.
So it's not the numbers that matter, it's the relation between each number and that.
Yes.
So with all these different points, are we describing different possible planes, or are we describing the one same one?
Yeah, we've got one plane, and we're picking different points on that plane.
For some reason, I'm seeing a box when I put all this together, but maybe I think I'm getting it wrong, because it's supposed to be a plane.
Yes.
Because if you can go up any two same x and y, and then go up and down however many degrees, doesn't that make a box?
No, is you don't have a complete... So I'm going to try to do a 3D version, not just in the one of good. So X is this way, Y is that way, and Z is up. So I plus J is the diagonal line here. And the K is straight up. So this is the plane that lies along the diagonal line and goes straight up. So all the points that we pick are on this plane. You see that? So X and Y are the same, so we go out along the line. And Z as we go up by. So your box is actually flat.
Would it still be a plane if it was like 3, 3, like all those except the z coordinates is the same?
So?
Like they're all four.
So we're picking a point?
Like 3, 3, and
3, 3, 4, that works.
And then 5, 5, 4.
5, 5, 4 works.
10, 10, 4.
Sure, that works too.
Gonna be a line, right?
These.
These are always four.
Yes.
And just do a line y equals.
Right. No, it wouldn't be y equals x, it's me three dimensions to describe it. So basically.
So it's equal four.
Equal, yeah. So does that answer your question?
Yeah. So what would it take for it to not be a positive? It doesn't follow the rule.
I mean, how could this not be a plane?
Well, I'm just like trying to visualize it.
Yeah, I guess a better way to conceptualize this is right now we're trying to figure out how to parameterize a plane. In other words, planes are important in Calc 3. And I'm describing surfaces now by parameterizations. So how would I parameterize a plane? And then we're going to move on is what are some other important surfaces? Because we're going to talk about cylinders, again, cylindrical coordinates. We're going to talk about spheres, parameterized spheres. You had those solids of revolution from Calc 2. Those are other two-dimensional surfaces that live in a three-dimensional space. We'll have a way to describe those. So different types of surfaces have different parameterizations. Planes are the simplest type of surface, and we're going to be talking about those. And we've done cylinders already. We did cylinders for your planes.
For that one, y is s plus 1. For the new point that you...
Very good, yeah. So if... Let's just... So if my plane contains 1, 2, 5, I plus j... I start with 1, 2, 5, and whenever I apply some I plus j's, x and y go up by the same amount. So y is always 1 bigger than x. So if x is the free choice s, what would y have to be? S plus 1. And then that k is completely different from those two, so k would be the free choice. And I want to contrast this. Originally, we had the equation of a plane that was z equals. Now, we're getting a different way to describe planes. Contains the point 789, and two vectors are I plus 2j plus 3k, and 4i plus 5j plus 6k. So let's say I'm at 789, and I do an I plus 2j plus 3k. And let's say instead I do 4i, 5j, and 6k. Where am I?
4, 5, 6. 11, 13, 15.
So my x started at 7, this is how much x changed by. So you guys know the game is you've got to give me some more points on this plane.
Could it also contain combinations of those two vectors?
Yes. Yeah, so I can think about it, I do an I plus 2j plus 3k gets me to here. And then this vector is also in the plane, so I could apply that.
So it's almost kind of like a basis.
It is.
Right?
That's exactly what it is. We just don't have those words. Oh, actually, it's a little bit different because it's not a subspace. It doesn't go through the origin.
Right.
You got the idea. These essentially form a basis for the space. And we're looking at every linear combination of those basis elements. this way. So the way you describe it is you take 789, and then some combination of the first vector. How many I plus 2j plus 3k's do you want?
Yes.
S many. Excellent.
Three.
We'll actually do the parameterization. So if I do S many, where S could be 3, agreed?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to do a certain number of the second vector, that's 4i, 5j, 6k, plus t of those. So what's the x coordinate?
7 plus s plus 4t.
Excellent. Y coordinate?
A plus 2s plus 4t.
Right. Be quiet. What's the z coordinate? No, you're good. You're good. You did 2 out of 3. I want to make sure everybody else gets this. What's the z coordinate? Louder? 9 plus. Plus. So I think you get the idea. I think this is generic enough to get that. And the parameterized version is probably the easiest of all. So R of t is 7i plus 8j plus 9k plus s times I plus 2j plus 3k plus t times 4i. 5k,
6k. What's the last variable for y?
3s. 5t?
Oh.
And underneath on that is 3s, right?
Okay, got it.
And that's a 3s. Right. Let me point out where those come from. Is that 5t. So that 5t came from this 5 right there. So the fact that's a y coordinate gives me the 5, and the t is in front of this vector. And this is the 3s, which comes from the 3 here, which is the z coordinate and the s parameter. Which ones?
Like, just the first one.
Okay, so x is...
Took all the first terms, add them up.
Very good.
Took all the second terms, add them up.
Yeah, so the point is 789. So the way I get the x coordinate is I start with my original 7, and then I do some of this plus some of that. The I is what affects the s coordinate, or the x coordinate. So that's 1 times s, which gives me the s here, and 4 times t, which gives me the 4t. So how do we get the z coordinate? I start with 9.
Yep.
So there's the 9. I do a certain number of this vector, and if I do s copies of this vector, how much does z change by? 3s, right? So that's where this 3s comes from.
Oh, okay, okay.
And then finally, this 6k, t times the 6k is the 6t. So where I want you to be is similar to where you were with lines. With lines, it's the way to parameterize it is you need a point and a direction. So the point's a point, and the direction is a vector. And we talked about how to put that together to get the parameterization. For a plane, you need 1 point and 2 vectors. And we talked about how to put that together to make the parameterization. Okay. And then there's kind of a special point first, or right now, or what we just did, was we had a point and two vectors. Another way that we can get a plane is as a function. So z as a function of x and y. So what I want you to do is just come up with some points on a plane. And then think about the thought process you went through to get those points, and then describe it as a parameterization. So can somebody give me a point on this plane?
0, 1, 3?
Nope. Yeah, look. 0, 1. I agree with you, Casey. You're right. 2, 3 at least.
Yeah. 13.
I like 13. How do we know it's 13? Yeah, because we plugged it in, right?
Yeah.
One more point.
0, 0, 0.
Okay, excellent.
Yeah.
Okay, so again, so I'm going to ask everybody for a different point, and the person sitting next to you just wants a quick explanation of what to say. So how would you describe in English your process here? So how do you how are you generating these points? So you're picking anything you want for x, right? So y is a completely free choice, and then do this calculation for z. So completely free choice for x, completely free choice for y. And then once you've made those three choices, that's the way you calculate. Or for people who like vectors. Let's go on to some more interesting shapes. I've got a mental picture of a two-dimensional surface that lives in three-dimensional space. I'm thinking about the hemisphere, so the top half of the sphere that has radius 1 centered at the origin. So first of all, what's the equation? And then, if you can, we're going to do this trick. We try to do this trick. Is that a function? Just the top half?
Yes.
So if it's a function, we can solve for z. So I get z squared is 1 minus x squared minus y squared. And the top half is that. And once we get a z equals, that's really setting us up for a parameterization. That means that x and y are completely free choices, and the way we get the z is just plug in to the formula. But
show you what we do if we can't do that trick. Oh, by the way, I made a dumb grading mistake. So some of you I took points off when I shouldn't have, and I don't have copies of your exams, so I just gave everybody some points. Either I made it right or you got some bonus points. So your score went up slightly from the last time you checked it.
Thank you.
Wait, how many points? What's that?
How many points?
It was 2.7% to your raw score. And then I based the curve on the raw, the original curve I used rather than recurving it.
1.6. Yeah, I did 1.6.
Well, everybody got a different amount of it.
Oh.
Depending on their score. But it was kind of a complicated formula.
What was our interest?
What was it?
What was the mistake? Or is it a grading mistake?
Yeah, just a dumb grading mistake.
Okay.
So I'll go for curve horse. Is it like the lowest score and the higher curve? Curve horse is a little bit around.
Yeah, no, it's the way I'll briefly talk about this, is the way curves work is I have a certain average that I want. And then, so what I do is I pass out a bunch of points to bring scores up to get the average where I want it. And the way I decide to distribute the points is the lower the score, the more points I give you. So anybody who got 100%, I don't give them any points, they don't know. And somebody who got 95%, they just get a little. Somebody who got 20% gets a lot of points.
So what if someone got zero?
Like zero is and they didn't take it?
No.
They just, if they took it and they got everything wrong?
Yeah, well, hypothetically.
Yeah, hypothetically. I've seen scores very close to that. Then they get a lot of points.
Oh.
Not enough to pass, but.
Oh.
Like your zero could turn into, what, 30% or something. It's totally like an F minus. Oh, any more? Like, administrivia?
Oh, that's an average.
Oh, yeah, no, I don't.
63, right?
You said 63.
Yeah, I can't remember. It was either a discrete math test or the Cal 3 test was 63.
Wow.
So, yeah, I can't remember which one.
Does that happen in your Calc 3 class often?
I don't remember. Again, if you really want to know, I'm happy to answer the questions. General statistics, I just don't know them off the top of my head.
Average.
But yeah, the class average after the curve was 80%, and then with the points I added in, that'd be 81%. You know, some teachers, tell me what's wrong with this curve, and then I'll go on. So some teachers take the highest score, do 100 minus that score. So if the top student gets 97%, then that means it was 3 points too hard, and adds 3 to everybody's score.
But that's not a curve, that's just linear.
Yeah, the top student. Oh, then zero. If somebody was able to do everything on the test, so nobody needs any extra points. So what's wrong with that model? Is you're using an outlier to determine what to do with the whole class, right? So the curve should be based on what the aggregate, what everybody did. Everybody should have a contribution to what the curve should. Anyway, I've thought a lot about it. Yeah, math people get complicated formulas. Anyway. We've
so
got
non-math teachers make those curves.
Embarrassingly, I've got some colleagues who do it that way. It will remain nameless. You're doing that role.
Well, is there an instance where, so let's say someone got like a 97, and then someone got like a 95, would that curve, since it's more favorable to the 95, would it like make it equal?
Yeah, no, see, that's a good point. Yeah, it's a good question. So if X is your original score, and your curved score is C of X, then you want the property, for else I'll say less than, is if my score starts out less than yours, then the curved score, my curved score is going to be less than your curved score. So my function has this property.
Okay.
And another property mine has, is you want the derivative of that function to be less than one.
And what, and this just means that the higher your score, the less you get.
Right.
So if C prime was equal to one, everybody would get the same amount. If C prime is less than one, it means that some people get more than others. The smaller the closer it is to zero, it's the more generous it is to the bigger people.
So you have less than equal over there. It's just on less.
Say again?
So you have less than or equal.
For here?
No, for the, yeah.
Oh yeah, good, you're right. So minus, I think it should be less than. Equal is where you add the same amount to everybody, which I don't think you should do. So I think your C prime was, so if the average was 63, your C prime should be 20 over 37.
Yeah.
Like I said. It's clearly a math problem, right? So how do I fairly add points to people's scores to make it a fair test? And then, it's, I know a lot of math, so I come up with a good way, math way to do it. Which is like, kind of the idea why you're here, right? Because eventually you're going to learn enough math tools that there's going to be people who are willing to write you a paycheck every month because of your math skills. That's the theory, right?
That'd be great. Let's see if it works.
And how what you might have to do before lunch
that theory works on
is...
That.
Describe
so.
A two-dimensional sphere. So it's the skin of the sphere that lives in a three-dimensional space. And you want to do it with parameterization so they can send it to the 3D printer and print it out. So it's your job to come up with an x equals, a y equals, and a z equals. So if you pick different values for the parameters, you get different points on the sphere. And if we had a function, then you could just solve for z. But this is not a function. It fails that vertical line test. So the tool I'm thinking about is we have an entire coordinate system that is built on describing spheres. What coordinate system is that?
Spherical
coordinates. Yes, it is. So what's the spherical description of the sphere? So what are the letters we use to describe spherical coordinates?
It's
rho. No, those are cylindrical. Rho.
B.
B.
Right. So that's what a typical cylindrical or spherical coordinate looks like. And so what's the description in those variables of that sphere?
Rho squared equals 1.
I'm going to even simplify it to rho equals 1. So remember, rho is distance from the origin. And if I look at all the points that are distance 1 from the origin, that's exactly what this is.
So it's kind of a subtle point I think I never realized. So it's spherical coordinates, this is actually a function.
Yes.
So the x, y, z coordinates, it's not a function.
Yes. So yeah, you don't have like a vertical line test. You can make up one, but it's not going to be just like a vertical line. And then, remember that we had a conversion from spherical coordinates to Cartesian coordinates. You remember this? What was the z?
Rho squared
cos
a cosine
v.
At one point, we talked about this. And do you remember what the y was?
Sine theta.
Okay, so these are the conversions, and then we know that for our sphere, rho is 1. So if we write it this way, so if we want to describe a point on this sphere, is what would you have to tell me? What values would you need to know? So we have two parameters. So there's our two parameters that describe this two-dimensional surface in the three-dimensional space. So the parameters don't have to be called S and T. I think your book goes through solids or surfaces of revolution, which are doable, but we're not going to use them here. Here it is. Okay, let's start chapter 18, I think. Yeah. Yeah, no, I don't think we're ahead, because we're supposed to finish, this was supposed to be on exam two.
Exam two is going to cover 7.3, up to 7.3, 17.3.
No.
That's where it starts.
Exam two.
We've just finished exam two.
No, I know. Exam two is supposed to cover 15 till 7.6.
Oh, really? Oh, okay. Are we ahead?
7.5.
Yeah, that sounds... So we're behind, right?
Yeah.
So we got the pacing schedule on the back.
Behind in terms of testing, but we can catch up.
Yeah, don't worry. I can talk fast. I've got one skill, the ability to talk about math quickly. Okay, so 18.1, and I'm going to motivate it, and then we'll eventually make it mathematical. So imagine that my iPod, my iPad, and some stuff in it weighs 5 pounds, and I'm going to lift it 3 feet in the air. It always starts out easy. How much work did I do? 5 pounds, 3 feet in the air?
15 feet.
15 foot pounds. Got a picture. Take away 5 pounds. Let's start it out here. Because I'm going to move it over this way. So I'm going to move it 4 pounds, so it's going to go 4 feet over. So it's here, and move it diagonally like this. Okay. So it's going to go over by 4 feet and up by 3 feet. So it starts out here. I bring it over to there. It's 4 feet over, and it's 3 feet up. How much work did I do?
25 pounds. No.
Yeah. See, it's going to be the same. Is this part isn't doing any work? They only do work when I go against gravity.
Oh.
So. Now we're going to come back to work. Okay, but now...
Come back to work.
Now we can represent this with our new language. Is we've got a vector field, just like we did with the sun and the earth out here. And we said at different xy points, we've got a force. Is if I put my iPad at different points, there's going to be a force at each of those points. What's the force?
Gravity.
It is gravity? In particular, how much is gravity pulling this down by?
5 pounds.
Well, this one is 5 pounds.
Oh, this one's 5 pounds.
Right, so it weighs 5 pounds. What that means is gravity's pulling this down at 5 pounds. And what direction is gravity pulling it?
Down.
Straight down. So if we put a coordinate system on here, so here's the coordinate system, is my field is -5j. So no matter where I am, the field is pulling the book there, the iPad down, with a force of 5 pounds. And this 3 feet, so remember that it started here and went up to there. So the displacement is what happened to that object? What's the displacement?
plus two P, plus two R, J.
Three J, exactly. And the amount of work is 15 foot pounds, which you get by doing the 3 times the 5. Okay, on this one, it's still the same book, still the same iPad, in the same field. The gravitational field is -5J. And what's the displacement vector if I go from down here to up there? How many eyes?
Four eyes.
Plus three J's. And the work is still 15. Okay, so this should be a review. So what are we doing with the force vector and the displacement vector to get the work? So yeah, we multiply the J coordinates together. See that?
Yeah.
Do you remember this? It is. So in physics, calculatively,
it's a new three guys.
Yeah.
Is that better to say that you're multiplying the absolute value of these J coordinates?
We'll talk about that. We have an even better way to say that. So when force and or it's, we'll say displacement and distance.
Okay. Cross product.
Close.
Cross product.
Yes. So cross product was torque, dot product was work. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
So then. Okay. So again, this is just review before. Is the way we introduced dot product was exactly this idea. So we didn't have a concept of a vector field. But the way we calculate the work is it's the force vector dotted with the displacement vector. So technically, if I dot this force vector with that displacement vector, what's the work?
Scalar.
It is? In particular, that scalar is? It's not 15.
Negative?
It's negative 15.
Right.
And we talked about this, right, as well? The negative work and positive work?
Yeah.
So negative work is we're doing work against the field. Positive work is the field does the work. So I'm not going to do it. If I had the iPad up here and dropped it, it would move from here down to here. It's fields, the field doing the work to bring it back down. So when I go against the field, it's negative work. When the field does the work to bring it back, it's positive.
Okay.
So, does this get interesting? This is the calculation we're going to be making quite a bit. Is I'm going to give you a force field, I'm going to give you a parameterized path, and you're going to tell me how much work is done in getting moving the particle along the path. So my force field is I plus 2j. I don't know what's generating this force. I just know that no matter where I am, I've got this force. Okay, and then is in this field, actually let me draw these force vectors here. This is the force that that particle is experiencing. So no matter where I put the particle, this is the force. So first of all, is the amount of work going to be positive, or is the total work going to be positive or negative?
Positive.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide this up into two parts. This will be the first path. This will be the second. So P1. What's the displacement vector for P1? So I started at 1, 1. I ended at 10, 1. 9, 1.
9, 0.
9, 0.
9, 0. And the force is the same everywhere. force is I plus two J.
One and an I.
F dot D is the work. Is nine I and I is
right here.
Nine?
Oh.
And how many J's are in the D?
Zero.
So it's nine plus zero, which is nine. Great. And then we'll do that path P2.
That's nine.
Good, so that goes from 10-1 to 10-10. Force is still what it is, I plus 2j. I think Travis said it. What is the displacement vector for the second part of this path?
9j.
Good. When I dot these two together, what do I get?
I.
2.
Oh, 0. 0, 18j.
19.
Final answer?
18.
18. 18. Yeah? That's 0i plus. So I'll work in feet and pounds. It's the field does 9 foot-pounds along the P1 path, and the field does 18 foot-pounds along the P2 path. Total amount of work?
27.
Joules are no joules are. Is that kilogram, meter?
Newton meters?
No, hold on. Joules are newton meters.
Yeah.
Yeah. So these are.
That's a metric thing from different.
Right, exactly. Yeah, what? Do we have a special name for foot pounds? I don't think so. I think we just call it foot pounds. Yeah, so joules are if you were doing this with newtons and meters.
I have a question to you. Here's a picture triangle there. In front of you. How come you didn't break into I and J like what you just did?
Because my field only has a J component, so I didn't have to worry about I. Is the I part would have been zero.
Oh, that's 4 feet right there. At the base.
I agree, but the field itself is only pulling down.
Oh, okay. Only one direction.
Yeah, so it's, I was trying to go with the intuitive idea first. I mean, I'll explain this a little bit. But when I'm calculating the amount of work is if I start here and move it over this way, all we care about is the vertical change. And for this particular example, the way that's coded up in the field is the field is 0i minus 5j. So when I did the dot product, the I part would have been 0. That's a good question. Calculus was in what we just did.
None whatsoever.
Yeah, zero, exactly.
We're about to integrate, aren't we?
Yes, we are. Very good. So instead of having a constant field, what if we had a field where we had different forces at different points? A differential function? Not yet. So what we're going to do is just we're going to go straight one before, 1, 1, 10, 1, 10, 10. So again, is this field, and it's going to look different, is, let's see, everything over here, so over here is going to look like this, and up here. Oh, but then this is increasing x, which keeps the same y, so these would kind of look like this. And up here, the y's get bigger, it's like that, and then it starts tilting up. So on this one, is the net work is positive, but there's going to be different forces along different points of this curve. Agreed?
Yeah.
So first, like before, we're gonna split this up and go P one and P two. And you know the calculus solution is, instead of doing the entire P one path, what are we gonna do instead? Yeah, chop it up. So here's P one. It's like this, it's 1-1 to 10-1. And again, there we go. These forces along here. Generic point along here looks like x comma 1. What's the force at this generic point? So that x could be xi plus
2j.
Exactly. So this generic point looks like this. The force is that. And what's the displacement vector for this? What's the direction? Good. So the magnitude, it goes by a distance of dx in the I direction. So over this small segment, how much work? Just x dx. Remember, dot products is, we ignore the vector part. Then we get the total work on P. Is we're going to integrate the work on that little segment. Good. So the x values that make this up, we start at x equals 1, and we end at x equals 2.
So the dot product here is giving you a function in the area.
Exactly right. So the dot product still calculates the amount of work in that segment, and the amount of work depends on the value of x. Let's look at P2. So P2 goes from 110 to 1010. And same thing, because I'm going to cut this up into a little slice. What does a generic point on this look like? Oh, that's not it.
Xi plus 2.
Yeah, it's 10-1 to 10-10, right? So what does a generic point look like?
10-1.
10-y. Agree? And what's the force on this slice?
10i plus
2yj. Good. And the d is, now we're slicing up a little bit in the y direction. So the displacement vector is dyj.
So how did it become, sorry.
What's it?
How did the force become different?
Oh, so it's, the P2 goes from 10-1 to 10-10.
Uh-huh.
The generic point looks like 10 comma y.
Okay.
And then remember that my force is xi plus 2yj.
Right.
And this generic point has an x coordinate of 10.
Oh, okay.
And the y coordinate varies depending on where we are.
Gotcha.
So I do a dot product. What's the dot product?
2y
dy. 2y dy.
Can we think of that as dw? If W is work.
Oh, that's a good. Yes, I like it.
And then integrate both sides.
Yeah.
At the same time.
How do I describe this? So what's the y value that starts?
120.
Total work is 1 to 10 x dx plus am I gonna make this harder?
Curves.
Exactly. So instead of having just nice, like this, oh, what if I had a field and I wanna know how much work is done in pushing something around a circle? So it's an electric field and you're trying to move something around on a circle. We can talk about that. So in my field, yeah, I can imagine another field. No, actually, if I had a current out like this, right? So if the current was a wire like that, I was trying to push this around this way.
That would be your magnetic field.
It would, yeah. So I'm going against the magnetic field or with it, depending on which way the current's going. It would be a positive or negative current. So how would you describe this curve? Can you describe a circle?
It's cosine and sine.
You can parameterize it with cosine and sine. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the sine and cosine parameterization, cut off a little piece of that based on the parameterization, figure out the work on the slice, and then integrate over the entire thing. So the reason that we did the parameterization was so we could describe any path through any field. Get a bit sad today. I'll be missing you guys.
Me too.
5 days from now, we will come back and do more of this stuff.